My respectful greetings to Dr. Sashi Bala, Director of NIPER and also the President of Association of Neuroscience, Dr. Anita Jagota, Professor at University of Hyderabad, neuroscientists, convener of this conference, of this conclave, Dr. Akshayanan, whom we just heard introducing the program, the Professor of Research, Neuroscientist, Molecular Biologist at PGI MER, Chandigarh, and Mr. Vinit Joshi, the President of the Joshi Foundation. Namaskaram, and all the great scientists, my hearty greetings to you all. We're going to talk today, deliberate on neurophysiology or neuroscience and how right and wrong affects our neurobiology. Neuroscience is perhaps, nothing is written on stone, nothing is etched on stone. Once upon a time when we were very comfortable with Newtonian theory, in between comes Einstein, blows up everything, comes up with theory of relativity. And then that is also questioned many a times. We now we have this quantum theory that also gets, you know, dilly-dolly, and then string theory comes into picture. So things evolve. Nothing is written forever. Neurobiology took a first evolution in the research of acetylcholine. Well, anyway, we won't go much into those because this, you guys are already expert on this. I will mainly focus on how right and wrong affects us. But what is right and what is wrong? It's both a relative term. What may be right may not be right in different different connotation. Cultural conditioning or cognitive biases, as we call in science, can deviate our decision-making processes. How you are brought up will alter your approach to decision-making. Even mundane thing in modern world, where we are in every country, I think mother-in-laws are very famous, and how they are also understood. In all these cultures, I'll share a small story to highlight the importance of the attitude we all have in, and that changes our responses at emotional level. And these emotional changes, emotional level responses changes our mental responses, and how this continuous mental responses in a particular way determines our neural pathways. Okay, that is my aim. We have understood right and wrong from our own perspective. Whatever I thought yesterday, or maybe 15 years back, or when I was a child, I had some idea of what is right. I do not hold perhaps the same concept now at this age. Many things change. So here goes the story. One day, one very enthusiastic man comes home with a telegram. You know, this is an old story. And in the telegram, it's written, "Mother is coming home." So he brings this telegram with a great pause and poise and joy and shares it with his wife. Wife starts complaining. "Why? We have so much of trouble. We don't have a maid coming, and your mother is coming." And she started all kinds of stuff and made the atmosphere very painful to bear. Well, husband said, "Wait, I'll go to a railway station, pick up mother, and I'll be back soon." So he goes, brings comes home, and he keeps ringing the bell. Wife doesn't respond so easily. But then somehow he managed to get in, allows mother to come in. And guess what? Wife starts crying. Why didn't you tell me my mother was coming? She took it for granted that mother-in-law was coming. So she created that fuss. And when she saw the mother, she was in tears of joy. See how the whole scenario changed. And certain things like of this nature keeps changing in our life and keeps impacting us all the time. Misunderstanding, prejudgment, precognition, preconditioning changes everything in our life. Whole life is all about precognition and based on cognitive biases. I'll share with you a neuro experiment. It was released by a public broadcasting station, TV station. Here it goes. Where certain biases have created an issue, where certain religious belief or a communal belief creates a different response. When a person is undergoing that experiment, at the same time, they have hooked up, I think, MRI or fMRI to see the responses to these various programs. So here is the presentation.
I've been researching this back in my laboratory. And here was my main question. When we interact with someone, does our brain function differ according to which group they're in? For every in-group we belong to, there's at least one group that we don't. And that division can be based on anything, race, or gender, or wealth, or religion.
We put 130 participants in the scanner. And here's what they saw. Six hands on the screen, and the computer randomly picks one of these, and then that hand gets stabbed by a syringe needle. Now that activates the pain matrix, which is what comes online when you're in pain or you see someone else in pain. Now here's the trick. We now added a label to each hand: Jewish, Christian, Muslim, Hindu, atheist, Scientologist. And the question is, would they care as much when they see a member of their outgroup getting stabbed? So here's what we found. Here's a subject, and when he watched a member of his in-group getting stabbed, there was a large neural response in this area of his brain. But when he watched a member of one of his out-groups get stabbed, it was essentially a flat line.
We scanned a range of volunteers, and there are individual differences, but the trend is clear.
A single word label is enough to change your brain's basic pre-conscious response to another person in pain. In other words, how much you care about them. Now, you might have opinions about religion and its historical divisiveness, but even atheists here care more about other atheists' hands getting stabbed than they do about other people. So it's not really about religion. It's about which team you're on.
So you see, this biases at our intelligible level are geared by our identification with whom we identify, not just intellectually, but emotionally. How do we connect a Muslim well connected with another Muslim, a great brotherhood, Buddhist well connected with the Buddhist, Brahmin well connected with the Brahmin, and you see the animosity between Brahmin and Sudras, or even Vaishnavites against Shaivites. All these things plays out havoc in our lives, and based on all these things we create a lot of problems. You are stressed out if someone is traveling with you. Earlier we used to say, bless you, my dear, when somebody sneezed. Today, if you are traveling by plane and somebody sneezes, we just, if you are sitting in 1A and the person is sitting in 2A, you'll not say bless you, you might say curse you. So how, the whole culture is also changing. Earlier, most of the tweets by President Trump, they used to be disliked. But the moment he sent out that I am COVID-19 positive, the likes went up. You see, the difference is when you are stressed out, when you misunderstand, when you are guilty, all these emotions with which you personally consider them as wrong. How does our brain perceive it? Is there any location in the brain where you feel the reaction to guilt, reaction to dislike that creates a kind of a stress? Well, a lot of experiment has been done and they have identified it is the prefrontal cortex and especially the right prefrontal cortex, PFC. Per contra, when you are quiet, calm, peaceful, what happens to this PFC, especially the left one? Left PFC will become more lighted up, more neurons will be built up, more and more you maintain this peace and quiet. How this peaceful nature of a person allows this amygdala to shrink over a period of time. How the gray matter density increases in a person who meditates regularly. These experiments are very important. They are telling so much of profound or absolute necessity to explore yoga in this direction, how it can help us get out of this stress. But like any other scientific approach, for example, vaccination. Vaccination is great to prevent diseases. Similarly, meditations and such yogic practices are great in as far as prevention is concerned. Once a problem kicks in, stress, anxiety, that such and such a thing has been identified causing you anxiety, causing you to become more stressful. But when you meditate, especially and focus on these causes of depression and stress, you will actually end up reinforcing the whole thing unless you are guided properly how to meditate. We are always going through this ruckus in our mind and in our heart. This ruckus is what? I like this, I don't like this. Most of you have already made up your mind that Daji is talking blah, 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 or I like this or I don't like this. When you are traveling in a flight or in a bus or in a train and there are co-passengers around you, how does your mind function? You start liking or you start disliking. At home also, when some new furniture comes for which you are not consulted, what happens to your mind? Either you like it or you dislike it. Only just to maintain peace or harmony in the house, you might change your opinion despite of your dislike. All these ends up creating an energy vortex. Your likes and dislikes creates energy vortex. Imagine for a moment when you are very happy, very joyful, for which you feel absolutely right. What is the condition of your heart at that time? Observe the condition of your heart when you dislike something and it's happening despite of your dislike. What happens to the state of your heart, the condition of your heart? When something wrong is going on, you observe it, you don't like it, your heart comes under some sort of a pressure. It becomes heavier. If you ponder further, what area of the heart does it start creating a different field of vibrations? Can you pinpoint that center, energy vortex happening there? I think today is not the time when we can discuss on this, especially the biologic or the physical location of such points. There are hundreds and hundreds of such points in our system, in our physical body. Yogic people, yogis, they call them chakras. Mainly seven are famous, but there are more than 100, I would say. They're innumerable. But especially such activities like likes and dislikes, that I'm attracted towards opposite sex, or that when I'm worried about my well-being, financial well-being, when I'm worried, constantly brooding about how do I look after my family, my job is at stake, I'm not making enough money, or though I have enough money, I'd like to have something more so that I can have other things also. All these thoughts. So when you broadly categorize this, likes and dislikes, they fall in two categories. One is about your sensual pleasures, and second is all about material acquisition. There are two broad categories. All these likes and dislikes, they gravitate towards one particular energy vortex in the chest area. Your attraction or aversion towards a particular person or a sex settles also on a particular energy vortex. Your constant brooding and worrying about your material world also settles down, these emotions settles down on a particular energy vortex, which is also around the heart. Now what happens when all the desires are fulfilled, for example, and you are at rest and say, oh wow, I'm doing okay, and you feel peaceful. Moment a desire is not fulfilled, what happens? You become restless. And that affects the next energy vortex. And if this restlessness continues because of non-fulfillment of desire, it turns into anger, and that anger settles also on a particular energy vortex, which is somewhere here in the chest area. When this restlessness continues, anger also becomes very dominant. Continuous state of anger for days together, irritability together, affects the next energy vortex and makes you fearful. Most angry persons, they have this trait, they're always fearful. And when a person is under fear for some time, he starts creating illusions. So there is an energy vortex also, which is full of discrimination, when it is in a positive trait, or it can become full of illusion when it remains under the fear, elongated fear, fear for longer time. And when you lose illusion, when you succumb to this illusion, you lose the ability to discriminate things, which is the mental process. So you can see how small things, atomic changes in our life or our responses to small atomic changes in life affects our mind, and how the health of the mind, positive or negative, affects our physical health. See, there was an example that I read in a book called Biology of Belief by Dr. Joe Dispenza. He emphasizes the importance of placebo and nocebo. I'm sure you all are familiar with nocebo. He studied a case that was in Italy. That person was under antidepressant drugs. Later on, he was given a research drug with a number, PM62 or something of that sort. One day he decided that I am going to commit suicide. And he finished off all the PM62 that was given to him in a bottle. He just took everything. And he simply collapsed. On the way to hospital, when it was called in that patient has taken PM62 experimental drug, they wanted to know what this molecule was about. And they found out that PM62 was nothing but placebo. Yet to that placebo, he responded it almost dying. Another example is also of a person who was to be killed, who had to be hanged. Instead of hanging, they say, we'll give him an injection. And they give an ordinary injection, to which also he succumbed to death. So many things of this affects our mind, and mind ultimately affects our physical health. You know, in also another book by Dr. Bruce Lipton, Biology of Belief, he talks about how the environment affects the genetic expression. You know, we have at the genetic level genome and epigenome. Genomes are fixed, epigenome can change. Like what we have in our life, fixed destiny and a free will. To a certain extent, because of our free will, we can change our destiny, but most of it, like genome, is unchangeable. In his observations, where a mother to be when after her conception, and when she is living with her husband or a family where there is a violent atmosphere in a ghetto, for example, in ghettos like Kings County, Brooklyn, New York City, where mother has to be always worried about her safety, where husband is sleeping with a gun under his pillow. Imagine the condition of a mother who is constantly under stress. Her sympathomimetic system is always releasing these stress hormones, adrenaline, okay, cortisol. This will surely cross the placenta barrier and affect the fetus. And you all know what is a sympathomimetic response. The blood rushes to the limbs at the cost of visceral organ. So the limbs receive more blood, more nutrition. The children born under such circumstances, they have usually longer limbs than their parents. At the same time, while the child was under stress, receiving the stress hormones, where the blood supply was somehow affected negatively in visceral organs, the digestive system also suffers. That's why in India, I don't know how many of you are familiar, moment Bahu, as they say, Bahu pregnant ho gayi. So now we have to send her to her mother's place. Why this tradition? It is only so that mother-to-be can spend her comfortable, peaceful time at familiar place, at her parents' place, where she will be well looked after and loved, where she will not be under stress. Well, the same experiment was conducted on mothers-to-be in a better neighborhood where there is no stress and a lot of harmony in a family. They found that the fetus development was great, the child born that better cognitive abilities, because when you are responding under sympathomimetic stress, the blood supply is diverted to the back portion, posterior region, at the cost of the frontal region, see, frontal precortex. So the back part of the brain will be well developed. The front will be less developed. For children who are developing in mother's womb, who is always under stress. In a harmonious family, this is not the case, but the cognitive ability is enhanced by well-developed prefrontal cortex. So, external environment also plays a big role in our brain development. And this development also leads to overall physical health, whether it will be great or not. Coming back to this right and wrong aspect, which is, I would say, two opposite things. Right and wrong, likes and dislikes, desires and desire-free, contentment and restlessness, or anger versus love, fear versus what we call courage, illusion versus total discrimination, clear discrimination. All this, energy vortexes are affected. Now, if you ask a person who is under treatment in a hospital after the heart attack, if you find out the circumstances under which this person succumbed to this heart attack, what were those circumstances? It just happened just like that? Or something that triggered it? Were you angry? Often, person under uncontrollable anger, the heart rate increases. It becomes heavier. It pumps faster. When you are constantly under stress because of financial problems, that also creates a certain field on the heart, and certain energy vortexes are affected. So when we do the psychometric analysis of the moment when this attack had happened, we can pinpoint that which energy vortex was affected. A trainer in yoga are able to pinpoint exactly where the problem is. For a moment, let me take you a little bit of a deviation when I can share with you a little more that based on this Panchabhutas, we have these five chakras, first, second, third, fourth, and fifth. Okay. First is the heart chakra, just for our understanding. In traditional way, we say first chakra is a Muladhara chakra. But for our understanding and discussion, we begin with this heart. Let's say that's the first one. Heart is all about desires and contentment. When desires are not fulfilled, it affects the second chakra, we call Atma chakra, where there is so much of peace. When peace is not there, what happens? You become restless. It affects the third chakra, which is a fire point. You become angry. This further leads to the fourth point being affected. It creates a lot of fear. And because of this fear, it ends up creating illusion. This is the fifth chakra. In Gita also, they say, person whose desires are not fulfilled becomes restless. Person ultimately becomes angry. And a person who becomes angry loses his compass. He loses his discrimination. He loses his mind. And a man or a person who has lost his manas or discriminating faculty has lost his humanity. Because manas, as they say, or man as we understand, both words are derived from this root man. Man means mind. And mind is lost. You are no longer a human being. You may have a human frame, but you have lost your humanity, you see. You lost your perfect health. So how to help a person before he becomes overburdened with the emotion or the energy vortexes affecting all these chakras that we just talked about? Is there a way how to permanently make a person diffuse his anger? Is there a way how to make a person get away from fear? All these are part of yogic practices, especially under heartfulness way. It actually shows you how you ended up creating this mess in your life. You need not even have to say. Suppose Akshay comes up and he takes a meditation session with a trainer of heartfulness. Heartfulness trainer, when he's face to face with Akshay, he'll be able to actually chart out within himself and feel where the problem is. They call it grossness or heaviness. And they would find that there is heaviness at third point. Does not mean that Akshay is going to have a heart attack. No. But if it can be cleaned, if it can be erased, if these complexities or the heaviness which is there, which is built up, can be removed, you will be feeling so free and you will be feeling so lighter that you feel almost that you are in samadhi kind of a state. And this happens because of this removal of precognitive biases that we have. Well, anyway, I would like to walk you through this process of relaxation and meditation and give you a taste of what this special meditation with yogic transmission or pranahuti can help one understand immediately. Instead of talking more and more on this aspect, I need not know the problem. I need not even see your face. But those of you who are sitting wherever you are and you like to experience this special meditation and see how you feel at the end of it, because through this transmission, we are going to remove a lot of negative biases and see how these energy vortexes can be fine-tuned, how they can be resettled into its original nature, and how free you feel at the end of it. Generally, I recommend meditation for 40 minutes to 50 minutes, but today we'll do only for 10 minutes, just to show you. And afterward, if you like it, you can log in and find out the beauty of this whole meditation and how you can take it further. Like any other practice, it makes you master of it eventually. How masterfully you can retain a sthita pragya state, how you can enjoy this freedom, how you can enjoy the lightness of being, how you can feel buoyant all the time and happy. For an argument's sake, I would end this talk by saying the purpose of our life, I mean, everybody wants to feel happy without an exception. Even an insect, dog or a donkey, everybody wants to have a comfortable zone. They want to feel comfortable, happy. Now ask yourself, can you be happy if you are restless? I doubt it. It requires harmony within. And how are you going to have harmony within until or unless you have contemplative mind? And how are you going to have a contemplative mind unless you are able to focus? And how can you focus unless your mind is trained? Meditation is all about training the mind. Now you can join the dot that there is tremendous relationship, overwhelming relationship between happiness and meditation. Not just physical health, not just mental health, but overall health, your spiritual health also, as they say, body, mind, and spirit. So I welcome you to this adventure. Log into HeartSAP, HEARTSAPP. Download this app and see how this meditation experience can change the way you look at life.